Hello and welcome. Welcome to this introductory webinar on modeling microfluidic scale processes using FLOW-3D. My name is John Wendelbo. I am an engineer with Flow Science, the company that develops the CFD modeling tool FLOW-3D. Feel free to jot down my email and reach me directly with any questions. It's john.wendelbo@flow3d.com. You will also be sent a link to download the slides and recording of this presentation a little later today if you are interested. And by all means, feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn, LinkedIn.com/Wendelbo. So, the agenda today, and one of the underlying themes will be multiphysics. And while I introduce FLOW-3D's multiphysics capabilities and talk about lab on a chip and applications, as well as inkjets, droplets, and 3D printing applications, in all cases, the take-home message is that FLOW-3D offers a simple, robust, unified and accurate modeling platform that is very easy to use, but also integrates a very broad range of multiphysics modeling capabilities. Okay, so the field of microfluidics has exponentially grown over the last decade or so into a rich field of research and industrial applications. The scope of applications and research interests is just truly mind-boggling, and I'm sure this slide only covers a small fraction of what is actually being worked on out there. But even if we restrict ourselves to any of these areas, let's say energy or microfabrication or drug discovery, it's quite obvious we have only scratched the surface. And if you walk around pretty much any research facility that is engaged with any of these topics, it's very clear that the lab, in fact, is the primary research setting. But as always, where there's experimental work to be done, CFD can almost always bring complementary insights to the design, development or research process. And this this slide shows the main multiphysics areas that are readily available in FLOW-3D. So, for instance, on the bottom left here in yellow, we have models that relate to moving objects, fluid structure interactions. These can be rigid body motions, so bodies moving through a fluid, or can relate to membranes or elastic deformation dynamics and fluid coupling. So those are more fluid structure interactions, or even can include thermal stress evolution models. Think, for instance, of stresses building in a solidifying liquid or ice or metal, for instance. We have physics that relates to surface tension processes, things like wetting or free surface or fluid-fluid interfacial forces. We have thermodynamics, heat exchange and transport, but also phase change. Then we have particle dynamics. And even DEM modeling, discrete elements modeling, through our associates in Flow Science Japan. We also have chemistry. We have the properties of the fluid itself or themselves. So Newtonian behaviors, also non-Newtonian rheology and viscoelastic behaviors. And then we also have porous media models, as well as very important models down here on the right relating to electro and magneto hydrodynamics. And this is what the models look like in FLOW-3D. All these models are basically activated at will in any combination that is required. And just as an example, let's say I am interested in electromechanics. I would click on electromechanics and then select which specific models I'm interested in activating. So this could be electric potential, fluid electric charge, dielectrophoresis, electroosmosis processes, or even electroheating thermal effects. So I would make my selection, and then it's a matter of defining fluid properties, specifically the electric properties of the fluid, and also the electric properties of solids that make the geometry of the problem of interest. So for instance, in this example, we are using electric charges to displace two droplets towards one another through a conducting field. This is on the 500 micron scale, so not that small, but still. And surface tension needs to be activated. This is what holds the shape of the beads, and of course is also key to the merging dynamics of the fluids once they enter in contact. I should add here that modeling free surface problems is really one of the major strengths of Flow-3D. Tony Hertz, the founder of Flow-3D, was one of the inventors of the volume of fluid method several decades ago. The method has been fine-tuned in-house for over three decades now, and now the proprietary version is called TrueVOF and is a well-known Flow-3D strength across a number of industries, from microscales to aerospace, metal casting, water, and many more. Okay, so it's worth mentioning that one of the almost, well, completely, in fact, ubiquitous features of microfluidics is that cells, bacteria, particles, and so on, even the fluids themselves, live in a very different world than we do, because in almost all cases, they live in a low or even very low Reynolds number condition. And to situate things a little, we can just look at the Reynolds number found in vascular biology settings. In almost all cases, we are looking at Reynolds numbers of, let's see, oops, Reynolds numbers, around order 1 or 200 or so. So, things are very different in those scales, in those Reynolds number, and the consequence is that it's almost impossible to mix anything through any kind of turbulent mixing. Interfacial diffusion is the primary process. You can see here that even when mechanically mixed, it's in fact very, very difficult to mix two fluids. They remain for the most part, quite separate. So there's an interesting experiment. It's called the principle of reversibility. You can look up the video on the web, but basically three dyes, three droplets are put into a very viscous fluid and then turned in one direction and then turned backwards. And what happens is that they come back to exactly nearly the same position without any mixing or very marginal mixing. It's called the principle of reversibility. And in Flow-3D, if we remodel the experiments, what you can see is we start here, turn around, and then move backwards a full revolution. And what you see is that, in fact, the droplets we started with, having gone around and back, ends up in the same position. And this is because inertial effects basically are completely negligible. Fortunately, though, we can get some help with by taking advantage of secondary circulations, Dehn circulations, sometimes called, in the fluid streamlines. Flows around bends, notably, can induce circulation. So in this example, for instance, this is an in-plane cut at the midsection. So right here, we have fluid coming in from this branch, fluid coming in here, and because of the bend, these circulations are created and more effective mixing can take place. This is the cross section at the exit. And then, depending on the details of the flow rates coming in, the curvature, the cross section, different types of circulations can be designed or created or observed, and this is very useful to be able to predict kind of the detail of these things in using CFD. I'm sure you've seen these micro channels many times. This is the reason why we have these bends here, because they help with mixing of different reagents. Okay, so something else that's useful is that because of these low Reynolds numbers, we can control the flow very effectively using pressure controls. The response of the fluid is fast because there are no inertia. So in this case, we have an inkjet application where we have a fluid coming in from the left, a fluid coming in from the right, and we want to avoid using multiple nozzles. We want to have one common nozzle helping us deliver different fluids different times in different places. And we can control what comes out of this nozzle, whether it's the red or the gray liquid, by applying a pressure pulse, which basically flips what's going out of the nozzle. So this is something we can model very effectively in Flow-3D. So for instance, we're starting off with blue. In this case, it's a viscoelastic fluid, but we start off with a blue fluid, then we apply a pressure pulse, and it switches to red, and then we apply a negative pulse, and it switches to green, and so on. So this is an example of where we can use Flow-3D to accurately think about magnitude of the pressure pulse, the duration, and we can also quantify, which is very important, the zone where we have a little bit of both liquids. Okay, this is blue, this is red, but there's a tiny amount there where we have a little bit of both, and this has implications in the quality of the print on the substrate. Okay, another example is to use pressure to control flow, but this time taking advantage of surface tension as well. This is a two-fluid problem where fluid one is shown here coming through, and then we have fluid two, and in fact two branches of fluid two. And if I go back to the beginning here and pause this, okay, we have a fluid income. The fluid goes through here and it basically exits on this side. And when we increase pressure, what you're going to see is that when we increase pressure, so this is the initial condition, fluid going straight through. By increasing pressure, we are able to overcome surface tension in both channels, first in this one and then in the other one. And in fact, these two sides have different interfacial tensions. And we are able now to direct the flow into one, two, and then soon three channels. So we can control where the flow is going by cleverly manipulating pressure and how it relates to surface tension. So these are straightforward simulations to set up in Flow-3D. This one is a bit more complicated, but it's interesting because we are also using pressure, but coupling this with a general moving object model that we have. And so this allows for these valves to basically go up and down depending on the pressure field. And these black kind of grids here, or these black pipes, are pressure controls. We can apply pressures at different locations and control where the fluid is being channeled. So it's a bit complicated to kind of see where things are going, but the message here is that by coupling pressure controls and a moving object, you are able to model systems of pneumatic valves very effectively. Okay, and so it should be quite obvious that, in fact, in many, many cases, multiphysics is absolutely the key. And there's, of course, much more to multiphysics than just pressure or viscosity, surface tension. We just saw moving objects, big theme, a big one, as well as phase change. Particles is a big one. Chemistry, porous media, all those things kind of circulate around and dictates, determine how the flow is affected and will behave. So in Flow-3D, one of our really major strengths is that we have a very wide range of advanced multiphysics, and this is coupled with really quite unique free surface modeling capabilities. We do very well on free surfaces, and all of this is completely integrated into a unified modeling platform that provides exceptional simplicity and also, it turns out, exceptional computational performance. So it's good to keep this image in mind. And as a matter of workflow, we want things to be simple, but we want them to be also very accurate and rich in terms of physics. So we always start off with a core platform, which involves basically the geometry, the meshing, defining fluid properties. Usually we have a basic flow dynamics, which is in microfluids very often laminar Navier-Stokes with either a free surface or one or two fluids or an internal flow with one surface. It can be any number of combinations, but we have some kind of flow regime. And then built on these kind of core hydraulics, if you want, we can activate a bunch of multiphysics at will. So we have surface tension, drift flux models, phase change, bubbles and nucleation, solidification, which is part of phase change, but kind of in the other direction from what people usually think of dissolving objects and chemistry, elastovisco plastic behaviors, non-Newtonian behaviors, electromagneto hydrodynamics. We can also include non-inertial forces. If you're looking at centrifugal problems, for instance, we have heat transfer, moving objects for rigid body motion and how it's coupled with the fluids. And fluid structure interactions is for elastic deformations of geometrics components due to fluid forcing. And then we also have for solidified fluids, we have thermal stress evolutions, and then a lot with particles and porous media. So lots of physics which gets activated based on the problem at hand. So an example of multiphysics, we have the bubble driven inkjet, and you probably kind of we might have just missed, well, actually, I'll let this play a little bit, second bubble. So what we have here is, in fact, this is an ink, there's a reservoir of ink down here, comes through a nozzle. And this here, on this kind of ring here, is a heating element. And beyond a certain temperature, fluid nucleates and creates a void, a bubble, which then expands and pushes fluid out of the nozzle and then contracts. And then the process starts again. So we start with a first pulse of heat, let things move out of the way, and then have a second pulse of heat. So now that I've explained this, you'll see, for instance, the temperature here goes, as the temperature goes high, there's some nucleation happening, and this is going to grow. I'll bring this all the way to the beginning. There you go. So it happens quite quickly. It ejects the bubble. Bubble moves out onto the substrate. And then we have a second pulse, and things repeat themselves. So one example of multiphysics, including heat transfer, phase change, surface tension, of course, and free surfaces, obviously. These are all free surfaces. Another example, so it's interesting how the fluids just look different at these low Reynolds numbers. In this case, we have kind of micro reactor, micro mixer. We're mixing, trying to mix at least particles from different sources, doing this mechanically, and we can use the general moving objects model to simulate the rotation of a paddle and how the particles are able to make their way through the system. So this is fully coupled fluid structure interaction in a rigid body sense with a prescribed motion for the paddle. In this case, for instance, so what did we activate? We activated gravity in this case. I'm not sure we needed to, but we did. We activated the moving and simple deforming object module. We activated particles. We activated viscosity. Lamina, the low Reynolds number, and scalars to be able to follow things a little bit. And then what this looks like in Flow-3D is that you simply have your geometry, your fluid level, and then we have a very simple meshing system in geometry, which in fact has profound consequences for in terms of optimization or design parameter space design. There's no remeshing involved when you change the geometry. So for instance, if I have the geometry is embedded in this simple Cartesian kind of rectangular square mesh. So we have a mesh that's very simple, and our objects, our geometry is embedded in that mesh. We don't fit the mesh to the body. We let the body float within a mesh. And this means that I could, for instance, change this geometry and just, that's it. All I need to do is swap the geometry file and run the problem again. There's no remeshing, no redoing anything. We just rerun the problem. So that's a powerful aspect. And just to show you what this looks like, we have something called the favor method, as fractional area volume object representation, which allows us to just embed our solids and get an accurate representation for the solver. So if you remember the example I had previously with the mixer, which really didn't work very well, so you can ask yourself, well, maybe I can do something a bit more ingenious. What happens if I, for instance, have these rotating pins to the flow? Do I get better mixing? So, okay, it's a little bit better. But all I did in this case was to swap the geometry. That's all I did. And if I want to try a different configuration, I can go to this one, for instance. And again, all I did was swap the configuration. I made it turn the other direction just to see if it made a difference, and so on. So swapping geometric elements is very convenient, and it's also makes it very simple and effective to run the design parameter space. All right, so lab on a chip, of course, it's a big theme. What are we interested in? Mixing, separating, these are all big operations in this field. We want to do some sorting, flow control, switching. We want to have reactors where we have control volumes, sometimes porous media if we're trying to model the interactions of two fluids through some kind of porous membrane. Sometimes we're interested in droplets, to isolate reactions, for instance. So these are all operations that we do well in Flow-3D, and with inkjets or any kind of bubble formation, we're interested in the flow and the free surface. Very often we're interested in the thermodynamics. If there's evaporation, once it hits a substrate, we may be interested in the residue analysis. Think of inks which have a portion of liquid and a portion of actual ink powder. Once the fluid evaporates, where does the pigment remain? So that's one aspect. And then also membranes. Sometimes we have fluid structure interactions as a way to as a way to moving membranes as a way to inject the fluid. And then for rapidly growing field of additive manufacturing. We're also interested in the flow, of course, free surfaces, thermodynamics, phase change, in this case mostly solidification, or viscoelastic behaviors, because these are in the case of plastics. In the case of metal, mostly solidification. In the case of plastics, viscoelastic behaviors, those sorts of things. Okay, so earlier on, I had the same slide, I think, with flow in the middle of all these physics. Really, I can put Flow-3D is in the center of this circle. Okay, so we can talk a little bit about surface tension, because it's so important to so many applications. And again, this TruVoff method we have is really an excellent approach for all sorts of free surface problems. So for instance, this is a droplet, so I think it's 50 microns diameter, and we're interested in seeing how it propagates through space and how it hits the substrate. So this is a trivial simulation to run in Flow-3D. And we are interested both in the free surface. This is what keeps the shape of the surface tension, and the free surface are what keep the shape of the ball of the droplet while it's traveling. And then, of course, the final shape is a function of how of the wetting angles between the fluid and the substrate. Okay. Same as before with fluid regions are the same as objects. You can have multiple fluid regions. There's nothing to change. You just run your simulation with a bit more complexity. But in fact, there is no more complexity. You just there's nothing to change. You just add fluid regions and start running. So it's these are droplets with two fluids. This is a flow focusing. It's a very common application. Fairly simple as well. We have two fluids and then surface tension and pressure pushing fluid from here. Okay, and we can look at this from we can look a little bit more at the evolution of droplets, different configurations, different geometries. Not a problem. In this case, we have a fluid coming in from the top, from the bottom, and from the left, a different fluid. And this is something that we see in the lab all the time, of course. We can look at things on a somewhat larger scale. And what's interesting in this example is the hydraulic feedback on the droplet evolution. In fact, the fluid, because of the divergence of the flow here, the recirculation divergence here, and it slows down, in fact, the bubbles, the droplets as they make their way, and they coalesce. And so, okay, that's something that we can expect if we try this in the lab. And we may want to do something about this. And like I said before, we can just change the geometry and see how this affects the fluid. So, well, we can change the geometry. Now the recirculations are a little bit stranger, and we can see that the geometry has, in fact, implications on the evolution of the droplets. But this, in all cases, once you set up the first problem, the rest is completely trivial because we are just changing the geometry and running the solver. No remeshing, anything like that. Okay, and it's always nice to see something in the lab. So I added this video I took on my phone a little while back. And so these things are so useful for many things, mixing, thermodynamics, emulsions, all sorts of applications with the droplets. And also included a slide just showing some validations with, lab experiments. There's a long history of accuracy with free surface applications with Flow-3D. And it wasn't always the case, but of course with recently, a few years now, with the hardware we have, we can do everything in 3D, full three dimensions, and get very accurate fully three-dimensional representations with completely affordable runtimes. And now, of course, you can see the detail of the inside of the bubble in three dimensions. It's all very instructive if you're trying to make sense of how things would mix into a droplet, for instance, in this case. Okay. So surface tension, this is an interesting example where we are trying to move blood through a narrow channel without any, we don't really want to have any mechanical devices, we don't even want to have pressure control, we want things just to move on their own through capillary rise or capillary wetting. And so this design specifically has the capability of drawing, this is a blood reservoir, if you would, on this side, and if you just with no particular pressure, and if you allow surface tension to do its job, the blood will be transported, delivered through this micro channel. Okay, and if you compare this with the experimental results, you can see very good agreements. The red dots are Flow-3D, the green dots are experimental, and the dashed line is a simplified, in fact, analytical solution, which turns out is quite accurate. So some good, interesting applications there. And this application is also very interesting. It's imagine an array, hundreds possibly, of pedestals on which we want to have a very precise amount of liquid, nanoliters. It's a very small amount. It's a very very small amount, and it's of course very difficult to measure nanoliters, and we have many of these, and we want every pedestal to have the same amount of liquid on each one, and our dispenser is capable of holding much larger amounts of fluid. So what we do is we come very close to the pedestal and then remove the droplet, and a small amount rests on the pedestal. So this can be precisely modeled using surface tension. This is a GMO, a general moving object, going down, and then we are allowing the surface tension to do its work, and then we move out again out of the picture. So calculating this amount, calculating the amount of contact that's required, etc., all those things are very straightforward applications for Flow-3D. So a little bit on phase change and heat transfer, and I just had to show you this a slide from David Sinton's group in University of Toronto, and I thought this was amazing. What they've done is they've basically created thermodynamic reactors on a chip, and they're able to control temperature and pressures, high pressures, high temperatures, and they're able to basically have phase diagrams. They're able to control temperature and pressure, and are able to look at the thermodynamic reactions of anything they want. They can mix pretty much anything they want on these chips, control pressure and temperature, and see what's happened. So this has very interesting applications in the energy field. You can see, so this I thought was so interesting, some bump phase change right there. I thought I'd put in these two fluids. I'd never seen this, so I thought it was nice to include this. And for us, we are able to control phase change through pressure and temperature, thermodynamics. So here we have a nucleation site down here. It's a plate that's being heated up, and we see some, well, we saw some phase change. It might be a little bit easier to see on this picture here. We're going to see some nucleation bubble that rises and then collapses after a little while. So you actually see things much, much better on the 2D form. And I'm thinking, actually, my apologies, this is from a different simulation down here on the left. But same process, heating, pressure, nucleation, voids open, and then the bubble evolves just following thermodynamic properties of the fluid and the gas. In the other direction, solidification. So for instance, imagine molten metal beads landing on a substrate. They cool off, they solidify. So the Ed Folani's group at Sunny Buffalo has done absolutely amazing work on this topic. This and magneto hydrodynamics using Flow-3D. So thank you for that. So these are some, this is an example of an injection of a molten metal landing on a substrate and solidifying. Another example, this is a laser welding. So we have, you can't see the laser, it's coming. Well, first you have a laser, which we can't see. Then we are adding metal beads, metal particles, and this substrate here is in fact moving. So first, let me go back to the beginning. What happens first, this is how laser welding actually happens. We heat up, we heat the fluid, we heat the solid metal. We create a little puddle of molten metal, and then we add particle beads, metal particles, and then we see a bead of weldment get created. So that's the kind of phase change in the opposite direction. Okay, an example of again laser sintering. This time we have a bed of actual beads, and we can see how these melt and are following the laser beam and form a substrate. Very interesting from Flow Science Japan, in fact, DEM modeling. And what they're doing here is that in reality you have beads of different sizes, let's say 15 to 25 microns. And when you put these down in a layer on a bed, how do they assemble? In fact, generally speaking, if you've ever seen an avalanche of a rock, the larger beads tend to migrate to the top. But you can simulate this very precisely, and then you have a very good starting point for your welding simulation. So if we then move on and so we can see the progression of the weld on the sintering on this bed as the weld, the laser progresses along the surface. So very interesting stuff from Flow Science Japan. Okay, and then a last very important topic, so electric forcing. So we saw earlier on that it's difficult for particles, it's difficult for anything to move out of streamlines, and the way to get things to move away from a streamline is to apply some kind of body force. So it can be a centrifugal force, which has the capacity to move particles away from a streamline, or it can be electromagnetic forcing, which also has the capacity to move particles away from their streamline. So most simple, I suppose, is electrophoresis, and then we have other models in Flow-3D, dielectrophoresis, and then we have a conductive fluid metal model, electrowetting, electroosmosis, and then Joule's heating, electric heating, and conductive fluids, so all solids. So electrophoresis, so basically we are applying a we are able to move particles along electric field lines. And so there's a net charge on the particles, and it moves those particles. It acts as a body force, which means that particles of different sizes or different masses, rather, will move at different speeds. So we have, in this case, for instance, an electric potential from left to right, and then which is moving these particles at different speeds. So in this direction, it's not automatically so useful, but if you do it in the other direction, let's say we have a string of particles of different sizes, of different masses coming through here, and then at this point here, we're going to create an electric potential. And what you see is that it's going to push away these beads, which is then going to help us differentiate and sort, basically, particles of different sizes using an electric field. Okay, so we start with a uniform flow, then we're going to activate this electrode, and this will in turn sort, push fluids at different rates away from the electrode. Okay, so that's one example of using electric fields to sort particles. Another interesting application, electrowetting. So we use both electrophoresis and dielectrophoresis. And what happens, well, let me just bring this back to the beginning. Initially, in fact, before we apply any charge, this shape is so it started with an arbitrary shape, 90 degrees here, 90 degrees here. It's just a quarter round. But in fact, surface tension is going to say, well, I want a different shape here. So the first part of this video is just surface tension. So it adjusts to the angles that are determined by the interaction between the solid and the fluid. So the first stage is an adjustment. And then at some point, we're going to, I should go backwards, my apologies. What I wanted to show was that at some point we're going to create an electric charge on this electrode, and that is then going to bring the fluid towards the surface, and that's what we call electrowetting, EWAD in short. Okay, so that's another interesting example. We've seen this one, but it's for dielectrophoresis, so we have fluid charge and fluids with varying electrical properties, and we're able to manipulate and move around droplets in conducting fields using this technique. Another example, electroosmosis, and for instance, in this case, we're able to push fluid through a system without having to use pressure controls. That's the big advantage here when you count on mechanical controls. So this is what's basically the schematic, and we have to define a few more things for these types of problems. And then the result, and this is a three-dimensional example, is that you're able to move fluid and able to move particles in the absence of any kind of pressure field. Okay, so a very effective way of moving things around on the small scales. And then heating, electric current flows through a material. It resists resistivity, and it causes materials to heat up. This in turn can include, can induce circulations. So in this case, we have four electrodes with a create an electric field, conducting fluid. It heats up, and what we create then are these well-known circulations. Patterns which then translate into fluid motion accompanied by heating as well. Okay, so this work now is, I have a few slides on magnetic body forces, and this is work that was all done by Ed Folani's group, again, University of Buffalo. And very much like the electrical charges we saw earlier on, which were deflecting particles. In this case, here we have a trajectory of magnetic or particles susceptible to magnetic forcing, traveling in the absence of magnetic forcing. And then if you apply a magnetic field, you can make these particles move, as you can see on the right-hand side, away from their streamlines. You can also manipulate particles the same way using a magnetic field. In this case, we are trying, or they are trying, to create a micromixer, which is uses beads, which then are connected to each other and then rotate in a control volume in order to mix different reagents. Okay, so and then one last example, self-assembling beads, extremely interesting. And these can then be used to functionalize or to co-opt fluid coming through this region and attract, so to speak, certain reagents as needed. So kind of incredible to see this, and these are on very, very, very small scales. It's amazing how you can control these elements using magnetic forcing. So take-home message, FLOW-3D offers a simple, unified, robust, and accurate modeling platform that I hope I showed you today integrates a broad range of multi-physics processes. It's a very kind of general presentation that I gave you today. If you have any questions about specifics of any kind of implementations, there's so many out there, and you know, you would just best to just email or call, and then you know, tell us what kind of applications you're interested in modeling, and then we'll be able to guide you as to what can or cannot be done. But if it's multi-physics, chances are it can be done very well using FLOW-3D. And with this, I thank you very much, and we'll be sending out the recording for these slides very shortly. Thank you.